We're going to go through four notebooks now, but I first want to say this, since we knew that most of you wouldn't have any or much experience with MR reconstruction, we kept it such that we will cover the topics that Christoph also covered, but now how to execute the reconstruction with SIRF. And along the way, I'll ask some questions. So if I ask one, please somebody answer, because otherwise I'll be standing here a little bit lost. And as Chris already said, if you don't, if you have problems with your system setup, then just ask somebody of the people in the room, like raise your hand. And I want to quickly ask, who has, does anybody have never ever touched Python before? Yeah, that's fine. Perfect, because I'll, we'll define a function along the way. So it's not a, so and the everything is explained. And as Chris already said, if you want to go through the cells, we just play press shift and enter. So we jump through. So then we see the goals of the first notebook. It's that to make sure that everybody has a working version of SIRF, which we already have, including me. Then we will achieve mastery in running these notebooks, which we already have because Chris explained it. Anything Chris didn't explain? Yes, we're going to be talking about the data format a bit that we have available to store magnetic resonance raw data in. Then we will have we will know how to get reconstruction running with SIRF. We will be learning a bit about Python. And we will reconstruct our first MR image. So if we go to the next cell, and we want to know this is a weird setup. Okay, and we want to know what is SIRF. SIRF, as Richard explained yesterday, it's an open source reconstruction framework to reconstruct PET MR data. And we're going to cover the MR side of this today. And it has a MATLAB and a Python interface, of which we are going to use the Python one. And it is coupled to an MR open reconstruction engine, which is a whole universe on its own, which is called the Gadgetron. So nobody expects you to know anything about anything, because that's why you're here. But if you want to use SIRF in the future, there's also a link here to the software documentation where there's a complete list of everything. But we're going to cover everything you need to know along the way. So this is the situation where we are in. We have a file with a yellow guy. We don't know what to do with it. So what we're going to do is we're going to give it to SIRF, which then either runs a custom reconstruction, or it sends it off to the Gadgetron, the reconstruction engine, and gets it back. And then we can extract the data out and play around it with the, again in Python, in our Python script. So the reasons why we like to use open source reconstruction frameworks are because it's to be independent of what the vendors provide, and we want to profit from all the work that the others in the community do, and it's usually shared in an open source manner, and we want to give something back, and it's a great way to have others continue to use your work once you're done with your PhD or postdoc or live, because then it's somewhere where other people can access it. Oh. And we use SIRF to send data to the Gadgetron, or use something else. So now we need to use VM, which nobody is. Then ignore this, and we go back to the tree here. And we open a terminal, which you can see if you go back to your main page in the tree, you can open a new terminal here on new. And then you go terminal. So you got a terminal running. And then you need to type Gadgetron, enter. Oh, God. Is there already Gadgetron running? Yeah. Running. Ooh. Multiple terminals. Ah, this is why the Azure doesn't stop it, right? So I have already a kernel running, which is good. Really? Gadgetron? Perfect. So it's running. So this Gadgetron is now set up in the background, and whatever we do in SIRF, we'll send it to the background server, and this will process the data. And we. Yeah, they can do the same, Or they can open the terminal in the VM and start the gadget run in there. Has everybody opened an instance of the gadget run? No? You're using Azure or the VM? Go to the VM. Da, ja, dann scg alt da einloggen mal. Enter, dann halt wieder reingehen. Und jetzt scg alt t. Ne, sorry, strg alt t, dann machen wir ein neues Terminal auf. Alt t. Und jetzt da Gadget schon eintippen. Gadget run. Ah, okay, I keep going and the other people. So, all right. So there has been a community effort some years ago to install a vendor independent raw data format in MRI, because the annoying thing is that you always have three different scanners and nobody can load in the data from the other guy. So there was an effort to unify this, and there's a wholesome explanation on this website, which is linked here. And of course, to make this feasible, there has been communication with the vendors, such that there are converters available, which then, when you have your scanner from Philips or GE or Siemens, you can easily convert this. Just a one-line command, it takes half a minute to convert your file into this open source raw data format. And then you have, like, you can unify your data sets. And to have a schematic overview of what's going on in this raw data format, as you can expect, it's some raw and some metadata, where the metadata sits in the header and the raw data sits in this blue data block. And in the header, you have parameters which are common to the whole exam. So you have your B0 strength, for example, the repetition time that Christoph talked about earlier, the number of points that you sample in each dimensions, or some other specifics. That's all stored in the header, which is some kind of an XML script. And the raw data block is something else. That's also what Christoph already talked about. So these are those acquisitions. So each the data structure of these blocks are that you have these acquisitions. And each of these acquisitions has another header, which just tells you how many points there are along these frequency encoding steps. So that's basically the one line when you sample this one right line readout. That's what's stored in these little containers. And it tells you just which line it is, at what time it was acquired, so you can do dynamic stuff, and how many coils you have. And then there's just a long array of data points, which are complex numbers. And now we come to the code bit. And we can run those first two cells. And if you haven't used Python before, you can see here that you import some modules. And you say, I import surf.gadgetron as P Python. P stands for Python, MR, and some other like operating system functionalities. And so if you want to use any of this stuff, then you should, so the functionality is covered in these packages. And if you want to call anything from it, you just type, as you can see here, PMR dot the number of the name of the functionality that you would like to use. So in this case, if you run this first cell, you see that there's a file name associated, and you can call the constructor of this Python object acquisition data using this file name. And then you see it's of the class. So this Python has this type method that tells you what type of data, what type of object you're having. And you see it's some acquisition data, which means we loaded some raw data into our program now. So the second node is just what an object is. I don't know, probably most of you are familiar with the concept of an object. And so in your program now, you have these variables and they have this functionality covered. Clustered together. So now what's important is what Christoph already said, that always sometimes you need pre-processed data. So what you should do next is that you pre-process them. So there's a function, another function which is called pre-process acquisition data. And this does some, for example, if it's something that's called asymmetric echo compensation, it decorrelates the noise between the different channels. or remove some oversampling along these lines. So just pre-process some of the data, because that's usually what you want to do before you start reconstructing. And if you run this and you look at your Gadgetron, you can see that Gadgetron did something. For example, now you see that there was, here in this stream, you can see that some gadgets had been opened and some others had been closed afterwards. So now this was one of the building blocks that was sent off to this background server and has been now pre-processed.
Is this standard, just pre-processing?
So the pre-processing is standard. And later we, so for example, if you have a, so you should always do it, because otherwise you have correlation between the different coils, and so the noise is correlated, or as Christoph said, that you have usually you can't save time by undersampling this frequency encoding, the readouts that you do in this one direction in the K-space. What you typically do is you even oversample it, because you can sample it so fast, because then you half the distance between the points, which means you cover double the field of view. So you avoid any wrapping of your thing. So, but you don't want to, if you want to look at this, you acquire this, but just look at this, so it cuts it out again. This is all the pre-processing that it's done. So this is standard. Yes? Yes. I mean, in this acquisition data, there's also the header information inside.
Yeah, so, when you say pre-process, what is the pre-process?
So the pre-process is something that we, so in SIRF, it's these three gadgets.
Okay, so it's always one chain.
Yes, so in SIRF, there's these three. You can add basic, I don't know what you can add. You can add lots of, you can pre-process as much as you want, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. Multiply by three, divide by four. Okay. And now to have an example of how to get a reconstruction object, we say we create a variable called recon, and PMR has this fully sampled reconstructor, which has a method set input, and we have to give it the pre-processed data. Otherwise, it's going to be complaining that the data is not pre-processed. So now we have a method. So yeah, now we have a variable which is called recon. And as I said before, so there's these Python objects, they cover, they have some functionality, some methods, and you can call them by saying variable name dot method name and give it some arguments, and it will return something. So this is something you should remember for later, because later you need this. So now, what now? So we don't know what to do now. So we call the help function that Chris has been mentioning earlier. So now the first programming task is actually to run the help function on our recon object and then see the list of methods that are available. So just please type it and run the cell. It's explained there in the little programming exercise. And then you have the documentation available for this fully sampled reconstructor, and we know what we can do. Yes?
So the data is fully sampled, right?
In this case, it's a fully data sample data set, yes.
Does the data object have some field that says it's fully sampled?
Yes. Yes. We're going to check that later. We're going to see it later. We're going to cover, now we do the fully sampled case first, and afterwards we look at coil maps, and then we just follow the same path as Christoph did. In the end, we're going to do some iterative reconstruction. But now just look at what the fully sampled reconstructor can do.
Run the cell is blue, and then?
Shift enter, yeah. Yeah, okay, so yeah, da ist ein Stern, das heißt, es processed noch. Das heißt, ist ein bisschen langsam. Kannst du da mal auf Raum gehen?
Also ich bin jetzt hier auf der.
Und dann bist du dann running? Der Notebook ist nicht. Das Notebook ist aus bei dir.
Moment, ich bin jetzt hier einmal hier, dass das ja von mir, da bin ich jetzt nicht drauf, sondern ich bin ja auf der virtuellen Maschine.
Okay. Ja. Richard, I don't know why her notebook is not running anymore. So we do help recon and we see the thing. I hope everybody managed to see this. And we have now methods which are available, like get output. They're called process, reconstruct, or set input. Set input we already used. And now the next one that we would call is process. So please call the process method of your recon and start the reconstruction. So there's always the solution cells that you can run. If you fail to complete the exercise, then you're back on track. Du kannst mal File und Hold machen, nur mal von vorne.
Also ich bin jetzt hier sozusagen, das ist der Browser hier von dem von der VirtualBox.
Zum Localhost.
Dann könnte ich das nochmal von
dem Azure auch machen, ich weiß leider nicht, ich muss, muss hier schreiben. So, okay, I hope everybody managed to call the reconstruction method. So actually, this was pretty easy. So the last thing we here is just extracting the image data. There you can see you call the get output one. You get some image data. You're gonna, and then it's just some not interesting stuff, but how to actually display the images. And now we can see what is in the file that we loaded. And it's a standard resolution phantom that you can scan in your scanner. You got some substructure there. Usually it's some water mixed with chemicals to have it generate a nice signal. And there you can see that there's some little dots that show you how good the resolution is of your image that you acquired. So this was already the first notebook. And here we learned how to run one. We saw how the data is stored in the raw data format. And we learned how to call the Python functionality, wrote a bit of code, just like 2 or 3 lines to get warmed up. And then we now we know how to reconstruct the fully sampled data set. Because basically now this is available in 2 and 3D. So the lines you just saw is everything that you need to know if you want to get a raw data file from your scanner.